We are ready to start a whole section on chemical kinetics. We know about chemical reactions, and when we studied thermodynamics, we learned how to predict if a chemical reaction would take place or not. But in this lesson, we're going to talk about the speeds or the rates at which reactions take place. So we talked in the thermodynamics unit about how, sure, we can thermodynamically predict that diamonds will turn into graphite under normal atmospheric conditions, but it's so slow it's not going to happen in your lifetime. So now we're looking at the speeds that reactions take place. So, reaction rate. How is it defined? It is defined very specifically as the change in concentration of a reactant or a product with respect to time. Usually, it's recorded in molarity, which would be concentration unit per second, but it doesn't have to be per second. For a slow reaction, it might be per minute, per hour, per year. Just depends upon which one would be an appropriate time frame for the reaction that you are studying. So let's look at a very simplistic reaction here. We see the reactants. They are the blue and the red, and it's turning into a product, and that's the purple. And we're seeing time being ticked off. So on the very far left, we see the reactants only. And in 15 seconds, nope, it's 15 minutes in this case, we see this, the second little picture where we're starting to see the purple emerge. And then up to 45 seconds, we see that we've used up all the reactants and we only have products. So you could monitor this reaction by looking at the blue. You could monitor the reaction by looking at the red. You could monitor the reaction by looking at the purple. And any one of those would be a way to look at the reaction rate. So let's look at it a little closer and answer some questions. What is happening to the concentration of A as time goes by? I'm not looking for anything profound here. Just look at what A is doing. It is the round circle. What is it doing as time goes by? Well, it's decreasing, right? So we see that it is being consumed, it is being used up. Now, here is starting to put some numbers with it, sort of, okay? What's going to be the sign of the change in its concentration? Now remember, delta is the symbol we use for the change in, and it is always final minus initial. Now, if we're looking at A, and we'll go back to the picture there, if we're looking at A, I'm sorry, I said it was the red circle. Correct that. It is the blue oval there. Looks kind of like a capsule, doesn't it? As A is being consumed, it would be the change in concentration final minus initial. And so we can then say, well, what would the sign be when you were monitoring A? Well, it's negative. Final would be a little number, minus initial a bigger number, and that would be a negative sign. So if we're going to monitor the rate of the reaction, what we need to know about a rate is it can't be negative. The rate of reactions can't be negative, just like you can't go a negative 50 miles an hour. You can go 50 miles an hour, you cannot go any speed at all, but there's no such thing as going a negative 50 miles an hour. Even if you're going backwards, okay, you can't go down the interstate at 100 miles an hour backwards and tell the police officer you were going a negative 100 miles an hour, therefore you were going under the speed limit, right? We can't go a negative speed. You can't go a negative rate. So what we do for a reaction in order to define the rate is we are going to have to take into account that the change in concentration is negative, but the rate of the reaction is not. All right, so the rate of change can be defined in terms of that A decreasing by this manner, okay? Notice the delta A, just that portion, and I'm gonna write that up here, okay, so I can kind of point at it. Rate of the reaction, we put a negative sign in there, which we're gonna talk about, okay? This part right here, just this part right here is negative. The change in concentration of A is negative. If I want the rate of the reaction to be defined by how A is changing, I want to need to put a minus sign in there because a negative value times a negative value will make my rate positive. Okay, so that's why we need that negative sign in there. If we're going to monitor a reactant and determine the rate of the reaction from it, we'll need that minus sign in order to have rate be a positive value. Now let's zone in on C. C is the purple stuff there. It is being formed, it is being created. So what is happening to its concentration as time goes by? Well, obviously it's increasing. So we can ask the same type of question with that. If it's increasing, how would we define the rate of the reaction in terms of C increasing? Well, delta C is already positive, right? So we could also define this in terms of the changing concentration of C as it appears with respect to time. We don't need a minus sign in there to make them equal to the rate of the reaction. Okay, no negative sign is needed. So if you're monitoring the rate of the reaction in terms of a reactant, you'll need a minus sign. If you're monitoring it in terms of a product, you won't need a minus sign. You keep in mind that rate is always positive, and then everything will work out just fine for you. Okay, now let's look at two different reactions. I have A plus B going to C, and then D plus E going to F. I see these two reactions here on the screen. I want you to look at those two and select the one that is the faster rate. Well, did you select the first one? Okay. In the 45 seconds, it is complete, right? It has completely used up its reactants and formed products. Now, we started with the exact same amount of reactants and products. So it's not like we started with more and therefore it takes longer. We started with the same amount of both, but in the top image, we consumed all of our reactants in that 45 minutes. In the second reaction, we still have some of the reactants left, and we haven't formed as many products. So it's happening at a slower rate. So if we did a change in concentration with respect to time, we would get a different value for both of those reactions. Now what we see here is a graphic of these rates, okay? This is a very simplistic reaction of only A turning into B. And we see the concentration is along the left-hand side and time is going across the bottom. So my question for you is this. Is the rate of the reaction constant during the whole course of the reaction? In this case, does it look like you're having the same change in concentration with respect to time at every 5-second interval along the way? Well, certainly it is not. We would have nice straight lines if it were a constant rate, okay? But we see that over time, it is slowing down. We're going to be looking at how to incorporate that into our calculations. We're going to be looking at why that would be as we proceed through in our lesson series. Okay, so calculations of rate using this method are going to be different depending upon which time interval are you looking at. Are we looking at a 5-second interval at the very beginning? Are we looking at a 5-second interval further down? Are we only measuring it in a 1-second interval, final minus initial over that 1 second? It really depends on the interval of what the rate of the reaction will be. Now, we can make intervals smaller and smaller. Let's say we try a 5-second interval, a change in concentration over 5 seconds. We do a 1-second interval, a change in concentration over 1 second. We do a 0.1-second interval, okay? We can keep making that interval smaller and smaller until we can say at this specific time, this is how fast the reaction is going. Now, let me give you an analogy that's not chemistry. You could be traveling between here, Lexington to Cincinnati, and you could on average be traveling 70 miles an hour. So you go the distance, you divide by the time it took you to do that distance, and you come up with 70 miles an hour. You're going fine within the speed limit. But when a police officer pulls you over and saying you're going 95 miles an hour right now, he is doing an instantaneous reading of your time. You can't argue to him that on average over the whole course of this trip, I'm only going 70, therefore I'm okay, officer. He's going to say, no, at this instant when my radar hit you, I know that you were going 95. So we've got to make sure that we understand the difference between monitoring it over a certain interval and knowing the instantaneous amount. When we look at a graph like this, and you won't have to do this on an exam for us here, but when you're looking at a graph and you're seeing how it's changing, you can measure an interval and see we have 50-second intervals across the bottom of that, you could monitor the change over a 50-second interval or a 25-second interval or a 5-second interval if you knew the values over on the left-hand side. But you can also determine them right there at an instant. And the way you do that is you determine the slope of the tangent line to that curve. So you take the tangent line of the curve, you figure out its slope, change in y or change in x, and whatever that change in that slope is of that tangent line, that would be an instantaneous rate. At that instant, this is how fast it is going. So we don't have to measure it over an interval. We can graph it and determine it at instances by having a slope at the tangent line. Now we see here on this graph that yes, indeed, the rate is changing as time goes by, and we see that as time goes by, it is slowing down. And that is very typical, okay? It's not always the case, but it is very typical that as time goes by, the rate of change of a reactant is going to slow down, and therefore the rate of the reaction is going to slow down. Now here is a graph just to let you know that you don't always have to monitor it in change of concentration. If you've got gases, it's easy to monitor the pressure change of a gas. If you're keeping a cylinder size the right size, you can measure pressure changes as time goes by. So you can define the rate in terms of changes in pressure just as well as you can in changes of concentration. When you use PV equals NRT, pressure and molarity are proportional to each other, so you can make those same kind of measurements. Okay, so this is defining rate. We know that we can monitor change in concentration with respect to time. For reactants, we can do it for products. We need to be able to get the same rate of reaction. We know the reaction rate doesn't typically stay constant. It slows down as time goes by. And what we're going to look at next is what we do if there are coefficients involved in our reaction. How are we going to play that out if there's a 2 coefficient or a 3 coefficient in a reactant or a product?